This is a fourth interpreter ported onto Plasma from a version called JonesForth by Richard Jones. More details in the description. My only brush with Forth was about 40 years ago. I think it was on a Sinclair Spectrum, but it just didn't gel with me, so I never used it. I was more into assembly code and traditional procedural languages like Pascal, so the postfix or reverse Polish notation in Forth was an immediate turn-off, as were the real-world examples, which looked like an alien language. Now, it may be too late to retrain the little grey cells, so I'm not saying I'm a convert, but I can say that I now appreciate the sheer elegance and power of the language, and it's been one of the most intriguing and fascinating projects I've worked on, and realise I threw the towel in far too soon. In fact, if anyone has any interest at all in programming or programming languages, even if you're never going to use it, I would recommend having a go at getting an interpreter working. This video is a basic introduction, but is by no means a tutorial. There are plenty of good ones out there. It's more to show the unexpected bonuses which can arise when you're forced to code everything yourself. Now, it may be reinventing the wheel, but I would have missed out if Plasma emulated a real-life machine, as it would have been too tempting to just run off-the-shelf programs. So here's my 1980s perception of Forth. The language comprises a set of functions called words. These are held in a data structure called the dictionary, which starts off preloaded with words which form the core of the system, but you can add more words later at runtime. You can enter one or more words on the keyboard. The interpreter looks up each word in the dictionary and does one of three things. If the word is found, it obeys the code associated with that word. Otherwise, if the word is a number, it's pushed onto a stack. Otherwise, it displays an error. And that's about it. Or at least that's what I thought. I'll demonstrate this with the ported version running on the PleX emulator, microcode 3. The JonesForth documentation and full source code for x86 machines is available on GitHub. The links are in the description. Now, there are two key files which are a mixture of tutorial and actual source code. They contain background info and diagrams of the dictionary, along with source code written in x86 assembler. So you can build the interpreter as is for your own x86 computer, or convert to another language, which is what I did for PleX. The system file, suffixed by S, is all you need to get off the ground. In fact, it's more than you need, but I converted it all as I didn't know enough to know which parts I could leave out. The Forth code, suffixed by F, can be loaded later at runtime to extend the system with new words based on the existing ones. Now, just two pieces of advice. Firstly, make sure you download the files from GitHub. I got mine from some arbitrary website and ended up with mismatched versions of the two files. So when I came to load the F file, some functions didn't work. And secondly, do not even look at the F file until you've understood the concepts in the S file, preferably by building it and experimenting. If you look at the F file with no Forth knowledge, you'll be in the same boat I was in all those years ago, and it may put you off even starting the project. Let's check out those three parsing scenarios. I'll enter a word which is not in the dictionary and is not a number, XXXX, say. Not found? Fair enough. Now for a word which I know is in the dictionary, words. Now in JonesForth, this word is actually defined in the F file, but I've added a Plasma-tailored version of it here for convenience. And by the way, some Forths are case-sensitive, so you may need to use uppercase, but this one is not. The interpreter scans the dictionary for the word called words and runs its associated code. In this case, the code displays all the word names in the dictionary. I can press space to pause a listing and escape to abort. The word names can include punctuation, so there are a few cryptic ones which take some getting used to. If you know a bit about Forth already, you may recognise some of these. I've added some more Plasma-specific ones for convenience. This one, page, clears the opera screen. And these load words tell the interpreter to read from mag tape or paper tape instead of the keyboard. I'll be using one of these later for loading the F file. Right, the third scenario was a word which does not exist, but is a number, say 23. Nothing obvious happens, but the number should now be on the stack, so it would be nice if we had some way of checking this. And here it is. The .s word displays the contents of the stack as a bracketed list of numbers. The stack is more correctly called the data or parameter stack to distinguish it from the return stack, which I'll come onto later. The parameter stack is, as its name implies, the main way of passing parameters between words. And this is like passing parameters between functions in some other languages, except that there's no compiler to manage the stack and type check the items on it. It's all down to you. As someone once said, with great power comes great responsibility. If I enter another number, then look at the stack. The 4 is now on top of stack. By convention, the top is shown on the right-hand side. You can enter several words, all on the same line, separated by white space. 678.s. And you can see these have all been pushed onto the stack. I've built in another word called showStack to help with the demo. It shows the stack contents at every prompt, which looks a bit cluttered but saves having to type .s each time. The word 0sp will zero the stack, in other words it discards all entries. Right, how about some arithmetic? The operators, such as plus, minus, multiply and divide, all operate on the top two items of the stack. They remove them, perform the operation, then push the answer back onto the stack. Here's plus. And here's multiply. So what about Boolean operations? Now here are some examples which compare the top two items on the stack. This is equals, and the result on the stack is 0 in this case, which represents false, because 4 does not equal 5. Let's try 4 and 4, equals. This time the top two items are equal, so the result is 1. There are also lots of stack manipulation words, such as drop, which discards the top item. 2drop discards the top two items, which is the same as two separate words, drop and drop. There's duplicate to duplicate the top item. And 2dupe, which duplicates the top two items. Let's get rid of those. 2drop. Swap swaps the top two items around. And finally, rot rotates the top three items, such that the third item is on the top. And just as an aside, it was the rot definition which caused my earlier problems with mismatched files. Okay, we've seen ways of entering numbers, but how do we get data out? Now one method is the dot word, which takes the top number from the stack and displays it. Now in JonesForth, this is not present in the core system. It's defined in the F file, along with variations to display numbers in various formats. So I'll use another word for now, called emit. Now this takes the top item from the stack, treating it as an ASCII character code, and displays it as a character. The ASCII code for capital A is 65, so if we enter 65 emit, you'll see the letter A followed by the prompt. If we want to tidy this up and put a new line after the A so the prompt appears on the next line, we can also use emit to output a new line character. The line feed code is 10, so 65 emit, 10 emit does the job. Okay, that's all well and good. But how do we add new words to do what we want? This is done with a word called colon. It's literally just the colon character, I said it can be cryptic. But first I'll remove the screen clutter by turning off the automatic stack display. No show stack. Right, let's define a new word called CR for carriage return, which outputs the new line character as before. We start with the colon word, followed by the name of the new word. Note these are both fourth words, so they need white space between them, which is spaces, tabs, or new lines. Then the definition, which from before was 10 emit. Then terminate the definition with the semicolon word. Now if we enter words, you can see the new word CR at the top of the list. And we can enter CR to test it, and you'll see a new line. By the way, if the dictionary already contained a CR word, the new one takes precedence. And some fourths may issue a warning, but this one doesn't. So say I decide later that CR would look better if it output a full stop than a new line. I could redefine CR like this. Words shows two words called CR, and I'll enter CR to see which one it uses, and it's used the latest. Now you can use the new word just like any other. This example displays the letter Y, which is ASCII code 89, followed by a new line. You can also use it inside a definition of a new word. Here's a new word called DY to display yes and a new line. Colon, dy is the name of the word, 89 emit, there's the y, 69 emit, there's the e, 83 emit, there's the s, and cr, there's the new line. Now using individual letters like this may seem a bit crude, but it will do for now. Character and string handling is possible, but is outside the scope of this video. Now here's another new word for displaying no. Check they work okay. DY, DN. You can see how quick and easy it is to write and test new words as you go along, and this is one of the selling points of Forth, although to be fair, other interpreted languages could make the same claim. What makes it different was revealed, to me at least, when you investigate flow control, such as if statements and do loops and so on, which are part of the bread and butter of conventional programs. Now at first sight this looks bizarre, but bear with me till the end. I mentioned that more fourth words are in the F file in the JonesForth system, and this is where the flow control words live. I'll look at the definitions later, but for now I'll just load the file and use the new words. I've not ported the complete F file yet, so this is just the first section on magtape. Words shows the new words, and there's else, then, and if. Now these can be used inside a word definition, so let's define a new word to check if a number on the stack is greater than 9, say. I'll call it query greater than 9, just a short name to fit on the opera screen. Now as before, we enter a colon, then the new name. Now the if word expects the condition result, true or false, to be on the stack. Our new word is going to compare a value on the stack with 9, so the definition needs to push that next. Then the relational operator, greater than, which when executed, as we've seen, will compare the top two items and push the result, true or false. Now we can add the if word, followed by the words to obey if the condition is true. Will display yes, dy. Now the else word, followed by the words to obey if the condition is false, will display no, dn. And finally, the then word is needed to mark the end of the if clause. And this is like endif or phi in other languages, so my immediate reaction would be to rename it, but that might be considered heresy by the experts. And then a semicolon to finish the definition. So let's test it. We'll put 8 on the stack. We'll execute the is it greater than 9 word. It says no. Try again with 10 on the stack. It says yes. Marvellous. Now write this again all on one line so you can see the if statement in all its glory. Or should that be gory? It's certainly not intuitive, not to me at least. Now here's something more ambitious, albeit crude, because I'm still new to this. It counts down single digits from a starting number on the stack. So colon, then the word, which is .cd for a countdown, begin. The condition means while the top of stack is positive. I'm going to add 48 to convert the number to an ASCII digit, then display it using emit. Followed by a space. Then decrement the number. Repeat, then output a new line. So the countdown from 5, 5 CD. And this was roughly where I gave up before. I was already struggling with reverse Polish numeric expressions, such as 4, 5 plus, instead of the more intuitive 4 plus 5, but now that familiar constructs, such as ifs and while loops, were just as alien-looking, it was a step too far. And this is all because I've been looking at fourth words, like emit and dupe, as if they were like functions in traditional languages. So I naturally expected things like ifs and whiles to be a fundamental part of the language syntax. But it turns out there is no language as such. Forth can only manipulate words and numbers, so we've seen all there is to see. Which means if you want to add flow control, you have to write it using, you guessed it, forth words. In other words, you are defining the language syntax, not forth. That's why if, then and else are just words which extend the system because they are not fundamentally part of the system. Which begs the question, what exactly is forth? Join me in part 2 to go under the hood and find some answers.